Welcome to Doing It With Styles on Worldwide Digital Broadcasting. Today, I got Sonny Charles. I got the Sonny Charles from the Checkmates. Right here, sitting next to me, he's going to talk to us. Mr. Charles, thank you so much for coming in today.
Thank you so much for having me here. I appreciate it, yes.
Well, your agent said if we didn't, we'd never work in this town again.
Well, he's known to throw threats around, but he's a nice guy most of the time.
Seriously, we're here to talk about an event that's coming up on October 23rd, is it not?
Yes.
At 6
yes.
p.m. at the Henderson Pavilion?
At the Henderson Pavilion with the Henderson Philharmonic. I'll be performing alongside the great Sonny Turner from the Platters fame and Miss Kelly Clinton Holmes. And so the three of us are going to be having a good time there. It starts at 6 o'clock.
What am I saying? Yes.
Starts at 6 o'clock. And you know what? It's a lot of fun working with Sonny. We've known each other for almost 40 years.
Wow, that's great.
Yeah, we played all around together, and he's just a real great guy. And as you know, he's a great singer. And you know, Mariano Longo.
Yes.
Orchestral events. Put this whole thing together, and he shopped this thing for 5 years or more.
Right, that's
trying to find a venue for it, and finally Henderson decided to do it.
Yeah, which that's a great venue out there.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah,
and it sits, in my opinion, it sits empty too much.
Yeah, I agree.
They should have more events out there.
I'm hoping that this event is going to create a desire for more events like this.
Yeah, it would be nice.
I'd like to see this on a regular basis. I mean, this is music that touched me when I was a young man and a kid and growing up, and it's an important part of my life. And to be able to go and see that again and see, there's a lot of entertainers out there that are this group or that group, and there's really nobody left from the original members. But you know, yourself and Sonny Turner.
Well, you know, I traveled for. Did 7 years with the Steve Miller Band.
That's on my list of questions.
Yeah, but going back to that, the original performance, you know, you see all of the classic rock bands and the classic R&B bands and stuff, and it's not many of them who can, you know, some of them are not alive anymore, and some of them just can't handle the thing. Some of them lose their voice and everything, you know. I've been lucky. Sonny Turner's been lucky. We still have our gift, you know, and that's...
And what's the name of the event? What are they calling the event?
It's called the Sunny Side of the Strip.
That's awesome.
They got two Sunnies.
Got the two Sunnies there, so I think that this is going to be
great. And we don't want to forget Kelly Clinton.
Absolutely not.
Yeah, she's the glue that holds this whole thing together between the two of us, you know.
And it's my understanding that this is the first time that the Henderson Philharmonic has done this type of a concert.
Oh, really?
And they're, you know, they're more into the classical and the philharmonic type stuff, and this is going to be the first time that they're doing kind of the popular, you know, music kind
of stuff.
Well,
this is going on all over the world. Like this, you know, the pop music is the music of our generation. You know, I mean,
was an art.
Yeah, Beethoven and Strauss and all those guys had their day.
Yeah.
You know, they need to get out of the way and let us do it.
Well, and you've done a hell of a job pushing them out of the way, too.
Well, you know what? You know, they push people out of the way to get where they were.
But a lot of the music, as it progresses and as it transforms itself, goes back to the roots of just, you know, beating on the table or whatever.
I keep telling people, you know, when they're saying, well, you know, this song sounds like this song and this song, you know, I don't know how you can sue people for plagiarism anymore, because there's only 12 notes.
Yeah, I was just going to say,
there's only 12 notes. I don't know how many ways you can come up with something original. You can't come up with anything original.
Right.
Everything has been done several times before, but I don't know, you know, but...
But I think there's some value to that. Because when I hear an artist or a group that, wow, that really takes me back.
Yes.
You know, and it reminds me of this, and it was a good time in my life. And it's or you've taken a song that you do a cover, and you've made it your own then.
Mm-hmm.
And there are a couple of performers or artists that have done that that I like their version better than I do the original.
Yeah, well, you know, that's one of the things. Occasionally you find a song that just fits.
Yeah.
You know, you can almost live it. It touches some emotions in you that maybe most songs don't.
Do you have one of those songs?
Well, I have about 20 of them. But,
okay.
And you can see them on Tuesday nights at the Bootlegger.
Oh, are you playing Tuesday nights at the Bootlegger?
I do. I just started this thing. I just did my fourth Tuesday over there with...
That's a great little venue, isn't it?
It's a great little venue. It sort of reminds me of the supper club stuff we used to do back in the day. But, you know, Lorraine Hunt Bono, ex-Lieutenant Governor.
Yes, I met her a few times.
Yeah, she owns the place along with her husband, Dennis Bono.
And they've got excellent lasagna there.
Oh, great food.
I love
it.
I haven't had
a bad dish there.
Well,
yet,
my problem is I had lasagna one time when I was there, and I haven't been able to order anything else
because
I really enjoyed it so much. Let's talk a little bit about the Checkmates and how they got started.
We got started, a guy by the name of Bobby Stevens, who was our leader back in the day, our band leader, and he and I were on the football team. We never played, but we dressed and were on the football team. So, and we were always singing on the bus back to to change back into our civilian clothes. So we started saying, well, let's start a group, a doo-wop group. You know, that was back in the 50s.
Right.
So we got some other guys together and we started a little doo-wop group, and then we added, and it was all black guys at that point. But then we were doing shows for the Chamber of Commerce, just little shows, and there was a guitar player, Harvey Trees, that came out and just did solo stuff. So he said, "You guys want me to back you?" Yeah, great. So we had some music behind us. So then he goes, "I know a bass player." Okay, so he brought this kid in, Bill Van Buskirk. And so then I knew a guy who played drums. So we had a trio backing us. And we were called the Fort Wayne Continentals. And so we, in order to keep our group together, we went to stay together. So we joined the Army. And they had a thing called the Buddy Plan.
Yep.
So you join and you can pick your whatever base you want to be stationed. So we chose Fort Lewis, Washington, up by Seattle and Tacoma.
I know it well. My dad was stationed at McCord.
Oh, he was?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. Well, so, you know, but there it was open at 4 o'clock. You didn't have to get a pass to leave, and you could just go on your own. It was like having a job. So we all got there. We got to keep our group together, and we finally ended up in the entertainment division. We got temporary duty with them. So we would entertain hospitals and do various things around there. My job was I would sign out instruments to the other soldiers that wanted them and get them repaired and stuff. And that's what I did. I mean, occasionally I crawled around in the dirt with the guys, but mainly I was doing that. And getting out of that, we ended up with just five of us, and the drummer, Marvin Smith, Sweet Louie. Sweet Louie was our drummer. I played the keyboards, Hammond organ, I played that, and we had Bill Van Buskirk on bass, Harvey Trees on guitar, and Bobby Stevens was trying to play trombone, which we finally broke it. It was so bad. He said, "What happened to my..." I think we dropped an amplifier on it, I don't know. But anyway, so he sang up front. He was our front guy, and we all would switch around. That was the key to our act, is that we all switched around. I'd play drums on one song, and then I'd be singing up front, and while another guy played the drums or we would teach each other songs. We never knew how to play.
Right.
We weren't musicians.
Right. You've just played by ear
we'd
and
play
picked
by,
it up, and
we'd teach each other songs, and we came here in 1964. We did our first audition. At the Thunderbird.
Wow.
And flunked it. The guy says, "You guys are a dance band, we need acts. You gotta have an act.
Yeah.
We need some comedy, you need to have audience participation." They told us what we needed to do.
Right.
We went back and worked on it. And we came up with skits, and we had props and cowboy hats and wooden horses and all that kind of stuff. So we got booked into the Pussycat a Go-Go.
Oh, okay.
So we came there and we were a show band at that point. And the town just really just locked on to us, and we just, you know, out of, and we found ourselves a home here.
Yeah.
And then we were doing that for a couple of years, and one night, it was New Year's Eve, and Garwood Van, who owned the Pussycat at the point, he came over and said, Frank Sinatra wants you guys to come play his New Year's Eve party at the Sands. But we're here. No, you don't understand. Yeah. Frank Sinatra yeah. wants you guys to play over there. So that's where you
that's
go.
That's a command performance.
Yeah, that's
you
where you're going.
You don't say no. You don't say no in this town to Frank Sinatra.
No. So, and we went over. We did, I just wanted us to do one set. We ended up doing two or three sets. We stayed there until the wee hours of the morning.
That had to be the highlight of your life at that time.
At that time, yes.
To a command performance for Frank Sinatra.
Coming right out of that, we got a contract with the Sands. Well, actually, it was for Caesars. Caesars was being built at that point.
Right.
So they hadn't opened, so they loaned us to the Sands. And we did maybe two or three jobs over at the Sands until Caesars opened. And then we went over to Caesars, and that's when everything just kind of exploded for us. We started doing national TV, and Nancy Wilson, the singer Nancy Wilson,
right,
she saw us at the Pussycat. Well, at that point, everybody was coming over to the Pussycat a Go-Go after they got off All the Stars. Sammy, Sinatra, all of the main room stars would come over, and that's where they would hang out. Because we would go to 6, 7, 8 o'clock in the morning. We were crazy. We wouldn't stop until everybody left.
It's fun to be young, huh?
Oh, yeah. And you know, as long as people liked it, we would keep doing it. And so that's where everybody hung out, you know. And as a consequence from that, we went over to Caesars, and it was the same thing. All the stars would come over, and they would hang out with us. We didn't go on until 1 o'clock in the morning. And we would probably finish sometime 8 o'clock. You know, we would just go. We do 2-3 hour shows. At that point, we probably had 150 routines, because that's all we did. We lived to do that.
You were entertainers.
Yeah, we were just really. That's all we did. You know, I might have drank a little bit, but that's that's another story altogether. But you know,
that's for another time.
That's for another time. But, you know, and it was really good. The checkmates was really good. And then the whole thing is, the struggle for success never breaks up an act. Success breaks it up,
yeah.
Yeah. So once all of a sudden we started doing, we were on national TV 78 times. I don't know how I remember these numbers. 78 times.
Wow.
In 1968, 1969, it was 72 times. We're doing all of these shows, Ed Sullivan, we're doing Mike Douglas and Merv Griffin, all those shows that were those variety shows.
Right.
And we were doing all of them. And next thing you know, we were just ready to go into, we still weren't the main room act, but the lounges were so big here in Vegas at that point. They had Gladys Knight and the Pips playing the lounges,
yeah.
Temptations, the Four Tops, you name it, the Righteous Brothers and Kenny Rogers and his group. All those guys were lounge people.
And I miss that.
Yeah.
We've lost that. I mean, that was one of the things that brought people to Vegas. And because you could go any time of the day or night, you could see a class act like yourself. And
it was free.
Yeah.
I mean, you walked in and it was $1.50 beer.
Yeah.
And
the casinos were making their money and they were doing okay.
Of course.
And you know, it's sad, but it is what it is now.
Yeah, well, that
that's why I'm so excited about this event that you got coming up.
Yeah.
Because it's a chance to kind of take that step back and remind me of those days.
Oh, yeah. Well, you know, I do pretty much the same thing when I'm doing my shows at the Bootlegger. I just go back into, I just do the shows like we always did it.
Yeah.
You know, I have people come up and sit in. I had a guy last night, great guy, Clarence McDonald, sat in with me last night, because he played with Ray Charles, he was part of the Ray Charles band, and we did "Drown in My Own Tears."
Oh wow!
And it was just great stuff to do, you know.
Well, if you ever need a really good tambourine player, I'm available.
Well, I just might do that.
But that's about all I can do. I can bang on that tambourine, but that's about it, you know. Yeah. So.
Good. Do you have more than one tambourine?
Yes, and I have one of the single layer, and I got one of the double, so.
He's a tambourine.
Yeah, that's right.
That's good.
It hasn't done much for my career, but what the heck.
Well, you know, it's a pretty tough to get a job.
Yes, it is. Yeah, it is. Well, I did a lot better in the 60s. But.
Yeah. Every band had tambourine.
Yeah, that's right. And you could always find that. So I have to ask you this. When you're performing, when you're on stage, do you find that you prefer the smaller venues, say, for example, the Bootlegger, or the larger stadiums or showrooms? Is there one that you enjoy more than the other?
Oh, I don't know. You know, it's sort of like when you're just in the moment wherever you are. Okay. That's the way it is with me. So, you know, I played with Steve Miller's band. We'd play out there, and there'd be 100,000 people at these big festivals. And I got the same enjoyment I do when I played a Bootlegger, where it's, the people are right there in front of you, you know, and you hope you don't sweat on them, you know. but you know, it's you just, you're in the moment when you do it, you know what I mean? And sometimes an audience don't respond as well as they do, but it doesn't really matter on the size of the audience. It's just sometimes you have an audience that will like it, they'll stay there, they'll applaud pleasantly, but they get all, you know,
they don't get all worked up.
They don't get all worked up. And then, so I don't know. To answer that question, I would just have to say, I don't know. You know, you just get there and you just go into the moment of your what you do. And it's all about just projecting and having fun.
So most of what you're doing today is solo, if I... correct
for the first time.
Yeah,
first time this well, I did a cruise ship back in February. I didn't enjoy it that much.
You say you did not?
I did not enjoy it.
That's what I've heard. I mean,
I think the thing with me, this was my first solo effort.
Oh, and it's hard to sing when you're seasick, or
no, I don't, you know, I don't really get seasick.
Okay.
They got this little band you put on that puts the pressure point right here, and it worked for me.
Good.
So I don't get seasick, but it was just, I think it was the experience of me doing solo for the first time
by yourself.
In that situation.
And you knew that you were the focus, and you didn't have everybody else backing you up.
Yeah, you know, and you got the ship band, you know, which are, you know, not knocking them, they do what they do, but
right.
But just for me, it was one of those things. I don't know if it was a lonely experience, but yeah, it was.
Yeah.
It was. That was a big part of it. And so now this thing at the Bootlegger is, I'm getting a chance to get used to me being a solo guy.
Gotcha.
You know, and it's just like a bunch
of fun. Are
you
liking it?
I'm loving it.
Good.
It's a bunch of fun, yeah. And you guys need to come by one Tuesday.
Try to keep me away.
I won't. I'll call you and bug you anyway.
we'd love to. My problem is that with what's going on here at the station, I can't always get out. But Tuesday night, I got the other show. That's all right. I'll get somebody to cover that. But we are so looking forward to this event out at the Henderson. I can't tell you. And when I got the call that said, hey, would you like to help us promote this? And it was like, oh, hell yeah.
You know, the thing about it is that I've done probably just about everything in this business that I could do. But I've never done a Philharmonic show.
Yeah, that.
So this was when Mariana said, "Yeah, man, well, let's do this big thing with the big orchestra and all that stuff." And I'm saying, "Wow, yeah."
Yeah. How could you say no to that?
I know.
And especially with all the work that he's done over the years to try to put this together, and he's just got to be floating, seeing this actually come into reality.
He's a tireless guy. He's probably he's just really focused on doing this.
Yeah.
And he's just beat on every door for over 5 years to finally he got this thing to happen. And so
People are going to be talking about this for a while.
Really hope so, because doing the rehearsals,
I know we
stuff,
will
doing the rehearsals and stuff, we've been doing them all this week, and it's just really going to be a great show. It's going to really be good. The energy, the background singers and the players, he got the A-list players. And oh man, it's going to be really good. I'm excited about it. Yeah. I really am. And I don't get too excited about stuff because I've done so much.
Yeah.
You know, but yeah, this is going to be fun.
Is there any moment in particular during this show where you're going to be performing that we should keep an eye out for? You got anything special planned that you're going to sneak in on us, or?
No, you know what? I go pretty much full bore the whole time I'm out anyway, you know. So
that,
you know what I mean?
Know you
so
do.
So as far as there being I'll be doing my hit song Black Pearl, of course,
right?
And
it's a good thing, because if you didn't, I think you'd have a lot of pissed off people.
Yeah. Well, you know what, they say you got to dance with who brung you, right?
Yeah, right.
So yeah, and you know, that was my big hit. So yeah, you know that. And
how did that come about? Where did that come from?
I know you've heard of Phil Spector.
Of course.
Phil Spector was the producer on the album we did with. We met Herb Alpert. Herb Alpert had A&M Records.
Yeah.
Alpert and Moss. And so he tried producing us, but he produced us like Tijuana Brass.
Yeah.
And it just didn't work. He had me singing a Marlene Dietrich song. Falling in love again, what am I to do? Can't help it. I said, no, Herb, I don't think this is going to work. So
yeah, I just can't see you in fishnets.
No, I mean, well, he didn't go that far with it.
Oh,
but,
good.
But I did have the big hat, but anyway. But so he called Phil Spector in to produce us, and they did Phil came in, and with his wall of sound.
Yeah.
And it was just like, what an amazing experience that was. When it came time for me to do the vocal, I had the flu. So I couldn't really sing that good. So he slowed the track down so I could sing it. And it was just going to be for the benefit of the player, so they'd right. have a vocal thing to play off of. And when he sped it up, now I sound like Alvin and the Chipmunks. He went, that's the magic. So that's when they released it like that. I hated that record at that point. I'm saying, everywhere I go, I can't sing it like this.
Yeah.
Because it's just too high. Right, so I can't do this. Funny thing happened. We went to Detroit, and we're doing a record promotion thing. And we're driving through Detroit, and we see a nightclub that says, tonight featuring Little Sonny Charles doing his hit Black Pearl. Little Sonny Charles.
What are you, about 6'2", 6'3", 6'4"?
Yeah, I mean, it wasn't me. They had somebody else.
Oh.
They had some kid who sounded just like the record.
Oh.
I said, he's better at it than I am. So, but anyway.
Yeah, yeah, I don't see anybody calling you little.
Yeah. Phil Spector was a major eccentric, I put it like that. He certainly was, man. It just like the experiences with him was a lot of times funny, a lot of times really bizarre. But he had his genius. He had his genius.
And that's just it.
Yeah.
The finished product
yeah.
is what counted. And that's where, like you say, that's where his genius was.
Yeah.
And you didn't always understand that, what the hell are you talking about?
But you know, sometimes you have to get, you know, people like that who are just sort of out of touch with reality in a way, but they're so in touch with what they're doing.
See?
Oh, is that you?
That's
it. Did I just describe this? No, John, I know.
No,
you're
not that.
You're not
But it's just like, you know, the station here is something that, you know, Ricky and Larissa and Christine and I had wanted to do for the community.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, we got a lot of people that said, what, you're nuts.
Yeah.
But it's starting to work. And it's starting to be a place where it's a platform for people that don't have a platform anyplace else.
That's great.
And so, you know, people like yourself are what is helping us expand what we want to do here. And the fact that you would take the time out of it, because I know you're busy and you're trying to get ready for this thing, the fact that you would take the time out here and spend with us is I'm sincerely honored, and I want to thank you. So
well, you know, I'm honored that you asked me, you know, because, you know, to do something like we're going to be doing over in Henderson at the Pavilion. I'd like to see people know about it.
That's my point.
I think people need to know this is happening, and it can happen more than once.
And
if people know about it and support, you know.
And I didn't know about it until I got a call.
Yeah.
And said, hey, John, you know, we're doing this thing out there, and we got Sonny Turner, we got Sonny Charles, we got Kelly Clinton. I'm going, holy crap, yeah.
Yeah.
But.
You know, it just seems like everything now is advertised on social media.
Right.
You know, you don't see much going on in the newspapers anymore as far as.
Well, we're going to blast the hell out of this.
Well, I hope so.
This is going to be out there. Yeah. And like I said.
Because it doesn't mean anything if nobody comes.
That's
see
exactly
it.
Right. You know? And I'm doing it for selfish reasons because I want to see you do it again next year.
Great.
So if you're successful this year.
Well, that makes two selfish guys up here then.
But a lot of times that's what makes it work. I had an experience a couple of years ago where I had some friends say, John, you got to come out to the Mandalay Bay. You got to hear this group. They're friends of ours. They're da, da, da. And, you know, they don't start playing till 10. Well, man, that's way past my bedtime.
I know.
And so I said, okay. So I said, I'll come out. You know, I owe you that. You're my friend. And so I had my excuses all ready and, you know, okay, I'll be there for about 20, 30 minutes. And then, oh, my phone's ringing. I got to go do this. I stayed there for the whole two shows.
Good.
They were absolutely phenomenal.
Good.
And if I hadn't, if they hadn't told me about this, I would have missed that experience. And so that's one of the things that we're trying to do is let everybody know this stuff's going on in our community.
And you know,
you
what?
Know, all that crap that's out on the strip, that's great. But man, all this other stuff is going on here that you're missing out on.
A lot of times people who live here, I don't know if they get jaded to a certain degree.
Yeah,
we do. About especially about local talent.
Right.
It's just like there's no incentive to go see local. Oh, we can see those guys anytime. So,
but if you don't go see them, no, you will not be able to see them anytime.
Because
and there is such incredible talent here locally.
I do, other than the bootlegger job, I do most of my stuff out of town. I travel.
Yeah.
You know, I had a real
good. And that's insane. This is Las Vegas, the entertainment capital of the world.
But you know what? It seems like all the hotel jobs are, you almost got to rent the room.
Yeah,
you got to pay for your own, advertising and stuff, and then you got to try to fill the room, or otherwise you get booted. You know, so I don't know.
Well, Ricky Cheese is going to help us change that.
Good, good.
and that's part of our goal. Okay.
You know, and you know, I don't really feel discouraged about any of it because you know sometimes that's just the way life progresses. You
right.
know, so. I don't know. You know, I've been in this business long enough, and I have no really great expectations, you know.
And see, that's the difference. I do. I'm more hopeful now than I have been in a long time about, because I see, and maybe it's just some of the people that I know, I see almost a movement coming mm-hmm. for this kind of entertainment, and more people are talking about it. They're sick of... Look, I love the Cirque du Soleil. I love all the shows that they do, but come on. I mean, there are so few shows out there where the singers are live, the music is live, you know, it's
You're
all
right.
canned.
That's right.
And I really appreciate those shows when I can go and see this guy's actually singing. He's not
yeah.
lip syncing.
Yeah.
There's not a track playing behind him.
Yeah.
That's a band, and that's what we all want to see. And
well,
we
you know it's sort of a lost art anymore.
It is.
You know to see the like myself and Sonny Turner, Earl Turner, guys Clint Holmes, guys like that who just come out, and I'm sure there's more than the guys. It's just the guys on top of my head, but just come out there. Just one person comes out on stage and go, you know, and just do a great show.
Right.
You know, and just you know it's. I'm not going to say it's a dying breed, but it's just the entertainment thing has changed so much to techno stuff.
Right.
You know, I mean, when you see singers that don't really sing, they just put the thing here and it's all canned and you don't even know, you see the lips moving, yeah. But you can't really see that they're not really in sync with the song that's being played. Yeah. But you know, that's where we are.
Right.
You know.
But I think we're getting better. I really do believe that people are more aware now, and they're saying, yeah, you know, I'm tired of this crap. I want to see this.
Yeah, you know, as long as we can find venues for it, you know, and so.
Well, if this event is successful, there will be more people paying attention. They're going, well, wow,
good.
Look at the show out there at the Henderson Pavilion.
Yeah,
you know, and the Smith Center. You know, I mean, that's a step in the right direction.
It is,
but it's only one step.
Yeah.
And we need more of that here, because I believe the audience is here. I mean,
even
just the locals.
I mean, it's over 2 million people in this valley. The audience is here.
Yeah.
It's just, you know, getting them to come to one spot.
Yeah.
You know,
and getting them away from the machines, because everything that we do here competes with gaming.
But, you know, on any given night, there's probably 100 shows going on at the same time. And so most of it is tourist.
Right.
You know, most of it is tourist, but
but as a local, I'm going to go to the ones that, and maybe this is just me, I'm going to go to the ones where I know the entertainment's live. Mm-hmm. I know there's a local artist. I know that I'm going to see something special.
Yes.
That's not just cookie cutter, the same old thing, you know, over and over and over again.
Uh-huh.
And that's where I'm going to spend my money.
Yeah. Well, you know, That's what I like too, and most of the shows I go, I'll go see the local acts. I'm friends with most of the people
right.
there, so you know, and I like to support, you know. So, but anyway, you know, I love Las Vegas. I've been here. I've been living here now for over 30 years.
Wow.
You know.
So you remember when Charleston and Rainbow was the end of the world, right?
Yes, I do. Yeah. And I remember saying, "Man, let's buy some property here, man." I'm saying, I don't want desert. Why am I going to buy desert?
Yeah, there's nothing.
It's a desert out here.
Nuts.
Yeah, you can get it for a few $100 an acre.
You know, I know. And there's thousands and thousands of those stories.
I
have a chance to buy this.
I'd rather get a Rolls Royce.
Yeah. So what do you like most about living in Vegas?
I just really love the, I guess it's because I feel so at home here.
Yeah.
You know, for so many years, what 50 years almost, well, over 50 years I've been here. And, well, not living here over 50
right,
years,
right,
but,
right.
but being here all the time. So I just really feel at home here. I got so many friends here.
There's some good people live here, huh?
Some real good people.
You get away from the strip and all the gambling and everything.
I live out in Henderson.
Of course.
Yeah, I live out in Henderson, of course. I almost missed that.
Thank you, Ben.
Yeah. But, you know, and I just really like it, you know. It's just a real, it's home.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it feels good. And I love the desert at night.
Yeah.
You know, it's awesome. And we got the lake, and we got Mount Charleston, and there's a lot to do here.
It's great
restaurants, great food, you know, you name it. So, I need to talk about Steve Miller, because I love Steve Miller.
Yeah.
I love the Steve Miller Band. How did you get involved with Steve Miller? I mean, most people are going to say, what?
Yeah, we're in a club up in San Francisco, Bohemian Club. And so we met up there, because we do shows and stuff up there, you know. And so we met there, and he was saying, man, I sure want to do a blues album with you.
Oh.
And that's really how we met. He came and said, I want to do a blues album with you, because he liked the way I sang blues.
Yeah.
And I'd never sang blues except there. I always did R&B and pop.
Yeah.
So, but anyway, every time we would see each other, he would see him mention it, he'd mention it. And then Louis passed away. And so after about 3 months after Louis passed away, he called me up and goes, I'd like for you to come up and do 3 days with me at the Fillmore in San Francisco.
San Francisco? Wow.
I said, sure, I'll do it. You know, I wasn't doing anything. I was about ready to retire.
Yeah.
And so I went there, and we did those
You ain't
days.
Never going to retire.
Yeah, I doubt you, if I will now.
You can't. Yeah.
I doubt if I will, you know, when they stop hiring me, I'll be retired. or unless the physically something goes wrong. But anyway, I did the Fillmore with him. He goes, man, I'm going to record two CDs, and I want you to sing on them. So we went and we recorded 40 something songs, and he did two CDs, and I'm featured on two or three songs on each CD.
Wow.
And so then he said, "Well, join the band." I said, "Oh, okay." The numbers got right, and so I toured with them until 2015, and I finally said, "You know, I'm an old guy. I can't do this. I love the shows." I told people, I said, "I get paid to travel. I do the shows for free."
Yeah,
because that's where I had fun.
Yeah,
but finally, it got to the point that I had to say, you know, and he was transforming now until he was doing a show like that. They toured this year with Santana, Journey, Steve Miller, Tower of Power.
Wow.
So it cuts the times down. So there really wasn't space for me to do songs in the show.
Gotcha.
And no good for me to just be standing up there doing background, you know. So it was all good, you know, and I love those guys. They're like, you know, second family for me, that band, you know.
Do you have a favorite venue or someplace that you... God, I love performing there. I'd go back there and perform 100 times.
There was a bunch of, it's a worn out phrase, but bucket list places.
Yeah.
Royal Albert Hall.
Okay.
In London was great, just to be there.
Yeah.
And Radio City Music Hall in New York was great. And then doing all of the festivals, you know, which is like 100,000 people or 90,000 people doing those things and stuff, is so overwhelming to see that many people, and you can go like this and you can look back maybe quarter mile away or half mile away and you see somebody who like this too, you know. So you know you're reaching them, you know. Yeah. And it's just like, yeah, it's quite an experience.
Do you have a place that I never want to go back there and perform? And you don't have to mention names because I don't want to get you in any trouble.
No, I don't really have that sort of thing, because, you know, I don't really have that much of a judgment on places, you
right.
know. Mainly, the audiences have always been nice, you know, and that makes it happen for me. Now, we've been some places and got rained out and got all this stuff happened and freezing on stage,
because
you're outside and it's cold. But all in all, the experience is just, when you look back on it, you know, it's all cool.
Well, I think the weather is going to be perfect for this event at the Henderson Pavilion.
Yeah.
It's a perfect time of the year to be doing it.
Yeah.
It's just starting to cool off enough, but it's still warm enough that you're not going to shiver.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm jazzed. I'm really looking forward to this. I'm hoping that we can make this an event that is going to be repeated more and more often.
Yes, yes.
And we're happy to help. Excuse me, in any way we can. Is there anything that you want to let people know about the upcoming event or any events that you have coming up that you want to make sure we get out there before we wrap this up?
Well, you know what? I don't know. I have something that I'm pretty jazzed up about.
Well, then let's hear it.
They're doing a scholarship in my hometown, scholarship thing in my hometown. So, and there's a good chance it'll be a Sonny Charles scholarship.
That
be offered to kids. The thing that makes it so unique is that the only thing that kept me out of college was high school. So I didn't graduate from high school, but so to put a scholarship in my name is sort of, now that's a really unique thing to happen.
That's got to be an honor. I mean,
it is
to have something like that. I mean, it's one thing to have a building but to have a scholarship fund in your name and your honor. That's got to be a legacy that is awesome.
Now, I don't know when they look back to say, you know, this guy didn't graduate. I don't know. Maybe we shouldn't put it in his name. And it doesn't matter.
But I think that's what gives it more value.
Yeah.
Is that you can overcome. And I don't mean having a lack of college education, because I don't really. It is a setback, but it's something that there are other paths for people.
Yes.
And not everyone is destined to go to college. You know, there are trade schools. There are a lot of ways that you can create and build yourself up and become successful. And you've obviously done that over the years and been able to take whatever gifts or talents that you have and create something that you've been blessed with.
And you know what? And every opportunity I get, I like to talk to kids who you know, might be thinking about dropping out of school and stuff, to say, you know, this is the way forward.
Yes.
Getting an education. The dumber you are, the less chance you're going to have.
Yeah.
And I don't mean dumb being dumb, but I mean...
No, I know what you mean.
The lack of
knowledge.
Of education,
yeah.
Of knowledge, yeah. And so, you know, and I do explain my experience that I dropped out, but I went and got the GED, the good enough degree.
Yeah.
You know.
I have one of those.
But you know what? And then I taught myself. I read a lot. I do stuff like that. And I taught myself. You know, I became educated. You know, I went to a community college for about 2 years, but my career took me away from it.
Yep.
And I went back to working again. And yeah, so I don't know. It's been a fun life, man. I've just had so much thing that happens every time I have a thing that I tell people. I was struggling in LA. I was homeless. I was a homeless guy for 3 weeks. And luckily I had a car.
Yeah.
I wasn't carless, but yeah. I was homeless. And from that experience, you know, I told myself, you know, you're better than this. You can pull away from this. And I did.
You and know, that has to come from in here.
Just not giving up.
Yeah.
And not giving up and to pull on past that, to be and having some of the best times of my life.
Well,
after that. But during that period, here's what happened. I gave up hope. When I say that, and I tell people, when I gave up hope, everything started happening. When I stopped all the expectations, I stopped trying so hard, trying to be what people wanted me to be, trying to do this, trying to be that. When I stopped that and just say, I'm going to be me. I'm going to do what I want to do. I'm going to sing the way I want to sing. I don't care about trying to sound like Michael Jackson or Stevie Wonder. I'm just going to do me. And once I did that, everything happened. You know, so I didn't really give up hope, but you know.
No, I understand.
But you know
what
I'm saying.
We're grateful because you've given us a lot of good music that I can't think of anyone who doesn't have favorite songs or a soundtrack to their life.
Yeah.
And excuse me, we look back and you know, I can say that about your music, about Sonny's music, about the doo-wop, about mm-hmm. you know, it's
sure.
just that has always been a part of my life.
Yeah.
And so I want to remind everyone, October 23rd, 6 p.m. at the Henderson Pavilion.
Can you say that? October 23rd, 6 p.m. at the Henderson Pavilion.
You do that so much better than I do.
No, I don't. But I can do it again. But
yeah, do it again. We do not want people to forget this. You've got plenty of time. Tickets are available. I think if you go to thecityofhenderson.com mm-hmm. And events, and the tickets are reasonable.
Yes.
They're like $20.
I know.
And for $50, you get VIP seating.
Yeah.
You get a meet and greet.
We get the grip
get
and grin.
Yeah, the grip. Yeah. I like that. So, I mean, my God, you can go down to McDonald's and spend that and be sick when you get done.
That's right.
No offense, McDonald's.
But the show is low cholesterol.
Yeah. Well, good. Hey,
yeah,
I like
yeah, I
that,
mean,
yeah.
so you don't want
and
to worry about
it. And it's good for the
this.
Heart.
Yeah. No GMO.
There you go.
The show is
yeah, gluten free.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
Please, let's make this event successful. We want to see more of this happening here in Las Vegas, Mr. Charles. I cannot thank you enough for coming. And
thank you
and
so much,
John.
I appreciate
this.
It. Yeah.
You're welcome here anytime. Anytime you've got anything that you're promoting, you give us a call. We got your back.
Love it. Thank
okay.
you.
Thank you all for spending a little time with us, and come back again to Worldwide Digital Broadcasting, doing it with Styles. And if we don't see you before, we'll see you later.